This last session, we are going to talk about hoping God for any ministry. And I called it ministry because if you look in 1 Corinthians, there's a verse there, 1 Corinthians 10:31, says, whatever you do, whether you eat or you drink, which we just did, do all to the glory of God. So whatever we do in this life is supposed to be done for the glory of God. Now, before we get started fully into this, why don't we finish our memory verse? How many of you have it memorized up to where we are? Do you think? This is a prayer, this verse is really, that you can say anytime. You are having a tough time, you can say the first line. Teach me your way, O Lord. And stop right there and make your heart teachable so God can use you. Go to the next line. I will walk in your truth. This is a choice that you are making. You want to be taught. You want to walk in God's truth. Unite my heart to fear your name. Now, I didn't explain this when I first started, but the fear of the Lord is one of my favorite subjects in the Bible because I used to live in Utah, not too far from the Grand Canyon. Have any of you ever been to the Grand Canyon? So if you go to the Grand Canyon and you stand there, it literally takes your breath away. It's so huge. It's so far down to the bottom that it helps me understand the fear of God. Not the fear like we talk about nowadays, but you stand there and you look at the Grand Canyon and you are just breathless with awe, respect, amazing. It's amazing to look at it. It's so huge. But then the fear comes in when you step to the side and put your toes over the edge. We went as a family, and when my kids were like in their 20s, and my older ones, and I walked down this trail, and when I came around the corner, I went, there was Paul out on a rock, clear out. It was just jutting over the Grand Canyon. And I'm like, what? I mean, one step and he's gone. So the fear is the fear of what can happen. The choice you make, what can happen. That's the same thing I like to think of when I think of the fear of the Lord. It does two things to us. It brings an awe, not in who we are, but in how amazing God is. And as you grow in your walk with the Lord, God will only become more amazing to you. I know when I was saved as a child, I didn't know a lot about God. And as I've grown as a believer each year, learning more things, experiencing God at work in my life when I have difficulties, then the awe that I have for God to know how amazing He is, how huge He is compared to me, how little and small I am, and seemingly insignificant, and yet He cares about me. And then the whole idea that when I have a choice to make, do I say, I don't care about God? No, it's the fear. I call it holy fear. It's a holy fear that you say, I'm going to make this choice, and I am accountable to God when I make this choice. He cares right now. The choice I make. And so that's the verse here. Unite my heart to fear your name. Then it says, I will praise you, O Lord my God, with all my heart. And I will glorify your name forever. And the next phrase is actually my favorite. But when you're memorizing a verse, you can't memorize the phrases out of order. So this one is, for great is your mercy toward me. There have been quite a few times since I memorized this that I said that to myself because I actually believe it. God's mercy toward me is magnificently great. It's huge. I don't understand it sometimes, but I know it's there. He is merciful. There are things that I do that I'm so thankful He doesn't open up the earth and just have me fall into it, that He doesn't right at the moment kill me when I sin, that He is merciful. So great is your mercy toward me, And the last one has two words that start with a D, and this is how I memorized it. For you have delivered my soul from the depths of Sheol. The whole idea of salvation, that you have delivered me from hell, that you, through Jesus Christ, dying on the cross for me, and my repentance and then accepting him as my Savior, believing in what he did was enough to pay for my sin. His righteousness becomes my righteousness. I mean, when I sing hymns now or songs and they have all about the gospel in them, sometimes I almost cry thinking what Jesus did for me. Because when I was a child, I didn't understand it all. But now I do understand it, and it's precious to me. And so the last part, he delivered my soul from the depths of Sheol. I love that line. And his mercy and his deliverance. So that's all three of the verses. You should learn them. It would be wonderful and enriching to your soul. You will never regret it. So let's go back to 1 Corinthians 10:31. Whatever you do, in word or deed, do all to the glory of God. Whatever you do, you eat, you drink, whatever you do, do all to the glory of God. Doing something for the glory of God simply means that God gets the glory. And you have to actually examine your heart. There are some times I sing special music and I'll get up here and I'll sing and I'm actually doing it for the glory of me. Or sometimes I minister to people and we're all the same. This is very human. You'll say, okay, I'm going to do this for them. I hope they appreciate it. It's done for your glory. But everything that we do, God wants us to do for his glory. And that's kind of under the whole umbrella there, ministry. Jesus had this attitude in him. If you look in Philippians 2, I'm sure you've read it many times. Philippians 2, he talks about the attitude that Jesus had, that we're supposed to have. Turn there real quick. Philippians 2, 5 to 8. I get it to open here. He says that Jesus, being found in appearance as a man, verse 8, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. For this reason also God highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name which is above every name. And if you go back, it tells us in verse 5, have this attitude in you that Jesus had. So you say, well, I don't know what God wants me to do. What's his will in my life? It's right here. God wants you to have the same attitude in your heart that Jesus had. He wasn't trying to grasp anything for himself. He instead became a servant. God himself became a man. He humbled himself. In fact, he died the worst gruesome death that there is on a cross. And he did it all because he was selfless. He was not selfish. We tend to be selfish. We tend to do things for ourselves. But Jesus did everything to please God the Father. It was all for others. It was not any for himself. So as you do ministry of any kind, and I'm going to name some kinds here in a minute that maybe you can identify with, you should do it not for yourself, but you should do it with the same attitude that Jesus had. Do it as a servant. Actually, the word there is slave. Do it as a slave of God. Do it for other people. All that you do. So what kind of ministries am I talking about? Hospitality in your home. Now, probably all of you have read Proverbs 31. This amazing woman. Okay, she does it all. You know, you read the verses and you're like, phew, I'm so tired. Oh man, I got to do all this. Well, one of my friends studied this and she said, you know, I don't think that this is actually one woman doing it at one time. I think it's like the whole span of being a woman, from young to old. It wasn't like in one day she sold things and made things and stayed up late and, you know, one day, that's it. That's all she did. It's like her whole life. These are the things she did throughout her whole life. We all have different seasons in our life. I found that out. When I was young, my whole focus was my kids, and then partially in ministry. I would get very sick when I would get pregnant, and so I was the only pianist in our church in Utah. So my husband would come home, and he would pick me up and take me to church just long enough to play for the worship service, and then I would go home and go back to bed. And so every single pregnancy, I basically starved to death because I couldn't keep any food down. And it was actually funny because the last pregnancy I had, I lost so much weight that I said to Les, I'm dying. I'm starving to death. I'm so hungry. I lost 30 pounds in the first trimester. And I remember looking at my legs and saying, they're so skinny. I like this. You know, they're never going to look like this again. Quick, take a picture. But I was miserable, but the ministry was mostly kids and the part of being pregnant and then going and playing the piano. And then I had that went, and then the kids were all here, and my husband was teaching Bible studies in homes, and he said, Miriam, we really need a babysitter. Okay, I spent all my teen years babysitting, you know. I'm a pro, but I didn't like it. And watching other people's kids. So he said, I want you to come to this house. We're going to have a Bible study upstairs, and I want you to babysit the kids downstairs. So, you know, I said, okay. So I came, and I'm babysitting him the first week. You know, it was different, so no problem. The second week, I'm sitting down there, and I'm hearing them laughing upstairs. They're having fun. I'm down there with my five kids, and this family's four kids, and this family's two kids. And I'm not having much fun. And then I knew they were having refreshments. I'm getting nothing, you know? I'm not getting any of this wonderful fellowship. I want to be with adults. So I started getting a really bad attitude. And it was like an inside attitude, you know? I didn't say anything yet. So I got worse attitude. And the next week, I got a worse attitude. And finally, yep, I had to say something. So I told my husband on the way home, I do not want to babysit those kids anymore in the basement. I'm missing out on everything. Why do I have to do this? And I think he was probably shocked because he didn't know because I'd been hiding it pretty good. And he said, Miriam, that's your ministry right now. Do you know the people who are at that Bible study, how desperately they need to know what God teaches in His Word? I'm teaching them. You've studied this before. You've been at Bible school for 3 years. You know this stuff. Right now, you're ministering something God treasures. You're taking care of their kids so that they can study the Word of God. Yeah, I was like really embarrassed and humbled and like, okay. And I thought, this is going to go on forever. But you know what? It didn't. Within 3 months, God called us to another ministry, and we were gone. And I said to myself, you know what? I was complaining because I had in my mind envisioned that this is what I'm going to do the rest of my life is babysit people's kids. And then it ended just like that, so quickly. And then I looked back and I said, you know, we have seasons in our life. Just like the lady in Proverbs 31, she had different seasons that she did different things. So wherever you are, I know I've met little girls that were young. I've met older teenagers. I've met some college girls. Wow, you guys have a great mix here. I love it. And then, you know, the rest of you are all young. I won't say any old people because that would be me. And, you know, we don't want to call ourselves old. But all of us are in different seasons of our life, and there's things you can do. You can, one of the things I wrote down here is you can be hospitable and invite people to your home. Some women have a real problem with this. They're like, I don't want anybody to come over to my house because my house isn't really that great. And it's not clean, and I don't really know how to cook. You know what? You don't have to do any of those things. If you can shove stuff in a closet, that's fine. You don't have to clean, and you don't have to cook. You know, just go and buy something. We went to a lady's house, and this was hilarious because my mom's a great cook. So we went to this lady's house, Les and I, when we were in college, and she wanted us over, and she was going to host us, and she brought out a coffee can. And she set it on the table. And I'm like, wow, what are we going to eat? I can't wait to see what this lady made. She made little teeny pancakes. And she had them all stuffed in this coffee thing. She was from Africa. She had them all stuffed in this coffee thing. And all we did is we take one out and we put butter and jelly on it. It was really good. Eat little teeny pancakes. That's all we ate all night. And I said, wow, I could do that. Another lady invited us to her house and she said, I want you over for supper. Well, my mom's a farmer. She was raised on a farm. You have two different meats. You have two vegetables. You always have homemade bread, you know, all this spread. So we go to this lady's house, and she had paper plates. That didn't bother me. I don't care kind of person. Great, I don't care. You don't have to, you know, do stuff great. So she had paper plates, and she had napkins. She had two little boys, and they were sitting at the table. And then when we sat down, she went, and she got something, and she put it in the middle, and we ate peanut butter and jelly sandwiches. I was like, wow, she didn't have to kill herself, you know? I kind of go the other way. When I'm having company, I do the opposite. And in fact, I kind of revert back to the attitude I had when I was watching kids sometimes, and I have to confess, because I sit there and Les will say, Miriam, I want to have company over here, and I say, oh man, I'm going to have to cook, I'm going to have to plan a menu, I'm going to have to clean the house, I'm going to have to change the sheets, blah, blah, blah. All this long list I'm going to have to do just to have these people at my house. And so I start working on it and getting it going. And I say, okay, what can I feed them? Well, I like to try new recipes. So I say, okay, let's get out my cookbooks or let's Google what's the most wonderful thing someone's ever done with chicken, you know, or whatever. And then I'm reading. So now I'm making it actually more work. But I kind of like to do new recipes. So the people come, and they're wonderful people. I love people. They come to my house. I'm all set. We eat supper. I serve them this great dessert, you know, ooh, ah, all that kind of stuff. And they have the whole basement they can have for their bedroom and everything. And when they leave, always, I end up saying to myself, Miriam, you know, you need to really enjoy the first part of hospitality as much as you do the last. Because I loved having them. Why was I complaining before they came? The problem is I have the wrong attitude at the beginning. I think it's going to be so much work. So I've had to tell myself one of the ministries is hospitality. Do it as easy as you can and make it a blessing the whole time. Don't make it so that you dread it. I had a next-door neighbor who was unsaved, and when we moved into our new house where we live right now, she came running over to our house, knocked on the door. Hi, I want to welcome you to the neighborhood. She said, are you like the lady that used to live here? And I said, I don't know the lady who used to live here. What was she like? Oh, all she did is clean all the time. And I said, oh, step on into my house. So she stepped into my entryway, and I said, why don't you open this closet right here? You know, it's not filthy, but it's not, you know, neat and tidy. And she goes, oh, good. You're going to be such a fun neighbor. Because I don't care as much about cleaning as I do about people. So if you're going to be hospitable, people are the reason you do it. And you do it all for the glory of God. So try not to make it about yourself. Other things that you can do is you can care for elderly parents. I'm in that stage of life right now where the next decision, lesson I have to make is, how's my mom doing? She lives by herself in a house in Utah. She's going to be 88 in 2 days. And so does mom need help? Does she want us to quit, you know, after we're done in Michigan and move to live with her and help her? And at this point, she says, no, I don't want you to live at my house. She likes living alone and she doesn't need help right now. But that's a ministry that you can have, caring for your parents or for someone else's parents. I have a lady in our church named Polly that I take care of. I go and see her when she lived by herself. I drive from my job. I work part-time for Les as his secretary. I drive down the road. I get to her house. I'd go knock on the door. She finally gave me a key. I'd let myself into her house. Hey, Polly, how are you doing? Great. Hey, do you need any groceries? Yeah. Okay. So she'd make me a list, and I'd say, okay, I'm going to go get your groceries. I'll bring them back in like a half hour. And then I'd sit there, and she'd say, yeah, I'm just eating supper by myself. You want to join me? So call Les. Hey, Les, care if I eat supper with Polly? Nah, I don't care. Go ahead, eat supper with Polly. I loved it. I would just drop in anytime I wanted to, and sometimes I would take my daughters with me. And my youngest daughter loved it so much, she still now drops in to see Polly, who lives in assisted living. A ministry to elderly people. There are so many other things you can do. Visit sick people. You can visit people who can't get out of their house. You can bake a meal for somebody. I had rotator cuff surgery, and I needed people to bake a meal for me. I hadn't ever had that before. And it was a good experience to be on the other side, to realize, you know, it's nice if they actually make you something that's good, you know, that your whole family likes this. And it's nice if they actually come in and not eat with you, but you get to know the person that brings the meal into you. And so baking a meal for someone. Right now, the ministry I have, because I'm in and out, is whenever they have a funeral at our church, I make a cake. And I just bought the stuff that I need for the cake, and I make Les's favorite, and I take a little piece out, and I make it for him. And then the rest I make for the funeral. And so I have it all in my closet that the minute they call, I can say, yes, I'll make you cake. I'll bring it over for the funeral. So it's a ministry that I have now. Some people have ministries here in church. Now, I'm not as familiar with your church as if I stayed here a while, but I'm sure you have Sunday school teachers. That's something, yes, shaking your head. Some of you are Sunday school teachers. I love teaching Sunday school. I was telling one of the girls, I had a class for women only. I really felt like there were women in our church who were getting passed over, that they didn't feel like they belonged in this Sunday school class or this one. So let's have a women's only Sunday school class. And I had an 18-year-old up to an 84-year-old. Had about 35 of them. And every week we would do something so they would get better acquainted with each other. And then I would teach the lesson, and then I would give them something so that during the week they would stay connected. And so teaching Sunday school, that's a ministry that you have. There are so many things that are needed in a church. I mean, I've watched around here all the different positions that people do. Women, there are so many things you can get involved in that could be a ministry. So the attitude that you need to have is the same attitude Jesus had. There's a lady in the Bible, Old Testament, that I really, really admire her. And her name is Ruth. And she is, when you first start reading about it, first you read about actually her mother-in-law and her father-in-law. They leave Israel, they go over to Moab, there's no food. And so they go over there and then Ruth, they have two sons, and Ruth marries one of their sons, and Orpah marries the other son. And then one day, her father-in-law dies. And then, I don't know how much longer, both husbands die. So you've got three women who are grieving. They're grieving the loss of their husbands. And then Naomi decides, I'm going to go back to Israel. I'm going back to Bethlehem, where she was from. And she tells her two daughter-in-laws, you know, you're both here from Moab. Why don't you stay here? Go back to your families. And Orpah says, okay. And she goes back. And Ruth says the famous things you've heard, songs and seen things on there. Don't ask me, Mom, to leave you. I will not leave you. I'm going with you. My people will be your people. Your God will be my God. And she says, I'm coming with you. So Naomi says, fine. So there are certain attitudes and characteristics of Ruth in this book that I've studied over and over and over again that is a woman's attitude that you should have in ministry. And the first one I want to talk about, and by the way, Ruth is one of the women that Peter was talking about, holy women of God who hoped in God in 1 Peter. The first thing Ruth did is she followed willingly. She did. She was willingly following Naomi. Naomi said, I'm going back. And she said, okay. And she went right along with her. Sometimes we have the wrong attitude. We want the ministry to be all about us. We don't want to follow what's already there, what's already been set up. Then the other one is she left everything. She left everything. I mean, if you think about it, she probably had siblings. She had a mom and a dad. She probably had a lot of relatives. She lived there her whole life. Are you getting the picture? She left all of it and went to a country she'd never been in, people she'd never lived around, and she left everything that she had. And sometimes God calls you to a ministry and he says, leave everything. Now, we lived in Utah, and after Les finished seminary, we moved out to Utah. I thought we would probably move to North Africa because Les wanted to be a missionary in North Africa. And I knew that when I married him, that somewhere we would be serving. But God called us instead to Utah and to this small church of 8 people. And we were there for 10 years, planted the church, loved it. And some people would say, oh, how nice, you get to live by your mom and dad. They lived 20 miles away. I was like, no, we did not move here so I could live by my mom and dad, because I didn't want people to think, I'm just going home. I'm just making it comfortable. I don't want to do anything out of my comfort zone. No, I wanted them to know that actually I went there because God called us. And it was hard. 10 years trying to start a church, keep it going, and ministering to people. And one day, Les told me, he said, Miriam, I think that the school we used to go to needs a teacher, an administrator, and I feel like God wants us to go there. So I said, I remember saying, oh, that sounds like an adventure. Yeah. Because I had relatives, I had a brother, a sister-in-law, a bunch of people there in Utah, all these friends. I grew up there. I loved the area. I knew the whole state really well. And all of a sudden, I'm going to leave all of that. And I'm going to go where? In February? To Michigan? They have snow until May. I don't want to go to, you know, oh, it was mind-boggling. And so we're packing my house, and I think it was so hard on me emotionally, I actually got pneumonia. And instead of leaving when we were supposed to, we left 2 weeks later because I couldn't do anything. I was so sick. And so they're packing my house and my mom, my cute little mom, she comes and she's packing the kitchen and she's crying. And I said to her finally, Mom, please don't cry. We're only going to Michigan. We were thinking North Africa or Israel. And she stopped crying immediately. She looked at me and she said, I don't care where you and Les go, but you're taking 5 of my grandkids. And I can tell you at that point, I had absolutely not a clue what she was talking about. Do I now? Oh, yes, I have a clue. I thought, you know what? I took those kids out of Utah and probably only 2 to maybe 3 times in the rest up to now is when she's seen all of them together. So you have to leave all of it. Sometimes God calls you and says, leave it all. I want you to leave everything and come and follow me. He wants to push you outside of your comfort zone. He wants to give you a ministry that is going to challenge you, whatever it is. I don't know how you have viewed ministry that you're doing. I don't know if you have joy, if you have an attitude like Jesus did. I don't know. But Ruth had wonderful attitude. Never in the book of Ruth do you ever see her in the closet crying or calling someone on a phone and whining or saying, poor me. Never. In the whole book, she never, and she could have. I mean, she was still grieving the loss of her husband. And she's in a country now where no one even knows her. And she's actually with her mother-in-law, who I'm sorry to say was whining and was kind of hard to get along with. I mean, Naomi basically said, you know, this is what God gave me in life. Woe is me. You know, I was full and now I'm empty. Thanks, God. And Ruth never's like that. She never has a pity party. She's wonderful, and she was polite. She did wonderful acts of kindness. I mean, I can't believe it. She goes and gets food and she saves some, puts it in her pocket, takes it back to her mother-in-law. I mean, in our culture right now, the mother-in-law, I'm sorry, they have a very bad name. I don't know why. I don't know what your culture is here. But out there, you say the word mother-in-law and people wrinkle their nose like it's some terrible thing. Well, I happen to be a mother-in-law. And I try really hard to have a great relationship. First with my daughters. I have two daughter-in-laws. And now I have two son-in-laws. Now, I only had one son-in-law for 8 years. And he was my favorite son-in-law. And then my daughter got married last December. And her husband, he's 6'5", he came up and he said, "You know how you call Brent your favorite son-in-law?" And I went, "Yeah." He said, "That's going to change." And I said, "Okay, we'll see. Go ahead, Pete." But, you know, the whole idea of mother-in-law, you know, Ruth, she didn't treat her mother-in-law with disdain. She didn't act like she was better than her. She didn't even reprimand her. She never said anything to her, but she had acts of kindness. She was wonderful. You can do things here in this church that are a ministry, in your neighborhood that are a ministry, simple things. You can take care of a child so a young couple can go on a date. How nice. I do that when I go to take care of my grandsons. I say, "Chris, Emily, go ahead, go on a date tonight. I'm going to watch the boys." Yay, wonderful. Because he's in a small church. He doesn't have a lot of people that do that. You can listen to an older woman as she recalls her husband's memory. You can go and listen. That's probably my favorite question to ask a widow. "Tell me about your husband. What was he like? Tell me about when you grew up. How did you meet him? What was your wedding like?" This friend of mine, Polly, she can't remember even who I am now when I go to see her. But she can remember what it was like when she met her husband. So I ask her, "Tell me about Gordy, what it was like when you met him. And then when you got married. And then tell me what it was like with all your kids." So you can do this. This is a ministry. Listening. That's it. You're listening to someone recall. You can go and clean their house. You can come clean my house anytime you want to. If, you know, you have a ministry you'd like to do, come see Michigan and clean Miriam's house. You can play music or sing to someone who no longer can see. We had a blind man in our church. I grabbed two high school girls. They had really nice voices, and I said, "Come with me. We're going to go to him over at the assisted living place. He actually plays guitar, and he sings. So we're going to take our guitar, and we're going to go over there, and we're going to have a wonderful time of singing." So he played his, we played ours, and all of us sang for about an hour. It was a ministry. It wasn't hard. It was actually refreshing and enjoyable. You can slip a note into someone's Bible on Sunday to encourage them. I don't know. Did you ever think about that? Write somebody a note. Just slip it in their Bible. They don't have to know who you are. Just write them a verse. Write them and say, I saw you at church today and you look like you needed some encouragement, so I just want you to know I love you and I'm praying for you. You don't even have to sign it. You can read the Bible to someone who no longer can see. I've done that. This man that couldn't see, and Polly. Polly can't see now. She has macular degeneration. She's blind. So I go and I visit her and I say, "Polly, when is the last time someone read the Bible to you?" "Oh, I'd love that." So I say, "What's your favorite?" Well, her favorite's Psalm 23, so I don't have to read it. I just quote it to her. I memorized it a long time ago. And then she'll say, "Well, read John to me." I mean, one day I just sat there and I just read and read and read. She hadn't heard the word of God because she can't leave her room. She couldn't see it anymore. An easy ministry, ladies, that you can do. Or you can buy flowers and give them to someone who rarely gets them. When I was a pastor's wife in Indiana, remember I told you about me and Les and flowers? Okay. So I was a pastor's wife in Indiana, and one morning, for some reason, when I got up, I just, "Oh, Les, I really wish you'd buy me some flowers." I was like begging him. I don't know what the morning was. Maybe I had a bad week. And he listened, you know, and then he went off to work. And I went off to a ladies' Bible study, and when I came back, I drove into my driveway, and there were flowers laying on my driveway, beautiful bouquet. I was like, oh, this is so amazing. Les got me flowers. I get out of my car, and I grab them, and I go in the house, put them in water, and oh, they're so beautiful. And I call my husband, Les, I got them. The flowers are gorgeous. Thank you so much. And I'm going on, and it's perfect silence on the other end. And I didn't know why. And he just said, well, I hope you have a really nice day. You know, glad you're happy. Then he comes home that night, and he's carrying a dozen roses, a teddy bear, and a box of chocolates. And truthfully, I didn't need anything more now. So I'm like, I don't get it, Les. Why did you buy all this? Well, we had a man in our church who actually owned a big greenhouse. And Les went, and he said, I'm in such trouble. I don't know who gave my wife flowers, but it wasn't me. She thinks I did it. He goes, oh, you need a lot of roses. So he gave Les all these roses, and you're going to need a teddy bear, and you better take her chocolates. So he brought me all this stuff, and then he told me, Miriam, I didn't give you those flowers. Really? No, I don't know who gave them to you. Someone else who's much kinder than me, gave you those flowers. But these are from me. These roses and this is from me. And I was floored. I didn't know who it was. And then later on, I found out a lady went, and she bought like 5 bouquets of flowers. And that day, her ministry was she went and laid them on the driveway of 5 women in our church. And I was one of them that she put. That's all she did. She never signed her name. I found out by asking a whole bunch of people who did it. But look what it did for me. It was like the highlight of my week. I loved it. So that's a ministry that you can have. Just look around. You can be just like Ruth and do ministry with a good attitude anywhere. Unfortunately, in our culture today, showing that you care is nothing more than a thumbs up on Facebook. Which actually I don't like. Someone tells you, you know, my grandpa died this week, and I'm really sad, and you give them a thumbs up. Now, they do have a heart now that you can give to. But that doesn't really do what total one-on-one ministry does. Or you can go on Instagram and write something to them and tell them, you know, they post something, you just write, great, I'm so happy for you. You know, that's not a ministry. That's not something, I mean, sometimes it does help. Like my friend who, her husband has cancer. I've been writing her texting her verses. She'll write me first thing in the morning and say, I'm having a really bad day today. I'm kind of getting hit by a wave that's shocking me because my husband, they don't know how long he's going to live. And she's younger than me. And so then I can't see her. I can call her, and I have done that, but instead, I just write her a quick email or a text to let her know how much I care. But you know what? That text is backed up by years of friendship. I have been her friend for a long time, so it means more. Ruth had a lot of different qualities in her, and I would challenge you to go through the book of Ruth and write down everything that you see. Every single quality that you see that she had. She was willing to stay home. She was a great listener. She let other people lead. She didn't have an easy life. It wasn't like it was a piece of cake for her. But difficulties had come into her life, and just like they come into mine, she responded to them. What do difficulties do in our lives? I've had a grandson that died 2 weeks before he was supposed to be born. And it was difficult. It was shocking when my son called me. And then the days following, it doesn't go away. My daughter-in-law was going to have to give birth in 2 days to a baby that was already dead. I was just like, oh, it was such a burden on me. I couldn't even imagine that. I'd never had anything but one miscarriage. And I couldn't imagine giving birth to a full-grown 5-pound baby that had died. What do hard times do in our life, like Ruth had? They help us to draw closer to God. They help us to stay focused on eternal things. They give you compassion for other people that you didn't have before. They change your heart from self-love to God's love. And that's what ministry is, forgetting about yourself and looking at other people and trying to help them. So I want you all to think about the verse in 1 Peter that says that we are supposed to sanctify, set apart Christ in our hearts, always ready to give a defense to anyone who asks you for the hope that is in you with gentleness and reverence. If you have Jesus Christ as your Savior, you have hope inside of you. And the hope that you have is not something, like I said, that's just floating. It's not something that's just a word that comes out of your mouth. It's someone. You have hope in Jesus Christ. You have hope knowing that He is the one that you are depending on for all of life. Now, my mom is a widow now, and her ministry that she does is kind of connected to what I'm doing right now. I actually am an editor, and I write a magazine that is just for widows. Although I am not a widow, I still go and interview or else have them send me articles on things they have done or thought about or God has shown them as they walked through grief. We've done the magazine now for almost 20 years. Four times a year we put it out. It's a small magazine. It's called Kara Fellowship, the Greek word for widow in the New Testament. And my mom, when my dad first died, my mom said, "I don't want your magazine. I don't want to be reminded that I'm a widow." Well, now it's 2 years down the road, and my mom says, "You know, I was a missionary's wife, and now I'm not sure who I am." We had a lady who wrote an article saying, "I don't know my identity now. Everything in my life has changed. What was normal is no longer normal." So I took the article and I showed it to my mom, and she called me and said, "You know, I read that article. I have lots of friends who have lost their husbands. I didn't even realize how many there were. And I want your magazine. I want to send it to them. I want to write a note. I want to encourage them." So my mom is no longer doing what she did, helping my dad reach lost people in Utah. But now she is finding something else that God wants her to do. And then every morning she takes a big picture book that has all of her relatives in it. She has 21 grandkids and 19 great-grandkids, and four of us. I have three siblings. And she prays through the entire family every day. Anything she can that she thinks God wants her to pray, and anything specific. In fact, ladies, she's been praying for this conference. I wrote her and I said, "Mom, I got to speak in front of all these Russian women. I'm a little nervous. They're so intimidating." You aren't. No, the pulpit's intimidating, but not you. And she said, I'll pray for you. I'll be praying for you the whole time." So I know when mom says she's going to pray, she prays. And that's a ministry that she has. She doesn't even have to leave her house. She doesn't even have to put on nice clothes. She can pray in her house coat with curlers in her hair. She can do it anytime, anywhere, because right now this is the season in her life that she doesn't have a lot of other ministry, but she can pray. And that's what she does. And she said, "I don't know how long I'll be on this earth, but this is what God wants me to do right now, and so I'm going to do it with all I can, all my heart, soul, mind, and strength for the glory of God." So I would like you to stand as we finish this about ministry. And I'd like to pray a verse that's my favorite from Hebrews 13, verse 20 and 21. Let's pray. "Now may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, equip you with everything good that you may do His will, working in us that which is pleasing in His sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen."